This particular story is just something that I hope many young brothers or even brothers that got sons will talk to your sons so they can learn from this particular story. So coming out of Washington State, you had a, male that was charged with second degree murder 2 years after he fatally shot a brother by the name of Dustin Hunt. Now, he was dating a young Mzungu female by the name of Lauren Heller. They were dating. Now, I say the shooting happened after Heller went to his daughter's room after he and his wife heard her talking and laughing with someone. It said when he went to his daughter's bedroom door, he was armed. Okay? So I want you to hear what, Lauren Heller says about what happened. I would play her account, but we're really gonna have this discussion definitely with the brothers. But let's go ahead and roll that clip.
So should I start with like the night? So the night, we were just hanging out. It's just like any night. We were drinking wine. We were watching Harry Potter, and we had just finished. Again, we had just finished another movie. But sorry. So I had gotten a text saying that people needed to be gone by 10:30. And I thought that if I put him under my bed, which I had done before, and if I left, then no questions would be asked, because I left. That's really all they care about. So that's what I did. And I waited by the window, and I watched from the lighting. I couldn't see inside the window. I could see in the just lights. So I waited and I watched the light turn on. And I watched it turn off and I thought, oh, awesome, okay, I'm gonna go back in. Everything's gonna be fine. And then I saw the light turn back on again and yelling. So I ran back in. And I saw my dad standing there with the gun. And I jumped in front of it. Because I thought if he saw me, maybe he would put it down and stop. And I just didn't want, I was just so embarrassed that I didn't want Nami to see this going on. It was just like it was so embarrassing, and it was my thing that I thought my dad just, I just thought it was my abuse, and I never tried to put it on anyone. And so,
Try to, if you can, try to maybe keep contact, eye contact.
sorry.
You're good. All right.
I stood in front of it, hoping that that would move his, at least put the gun down. And Nobby was putting his clothes on. He was putting his hood on, his hoodie on. And we were getting ready to leave. And I was standing by the door, and my dad was standing next to me, kind of like in front of the door, and then progressed in front of the bed. So we were all standing in front of my bed, which my bed has about, this much space between it. Well, it's like this much space. So for two grown men to be standing in that space, I mean, you're touching. You're very close to each other. And that's the point where my dad claimed to have fallen, because Dustin moved the gun out of my line, out of the way that I was walking. And my dad took that as, oh, he's trying to reach for it. When there was no grab, it was literally to move, and that's when he fell. My dad fell against He fell against the bed and held on to Dustin. And I felt that because Dustin went down and I was holding on to him and I was holding him. And I was like, let's get out of here. Let's go. And we're trying to go. And my dad held on to him. He shot him. He held onto him and shot him. And he looked at me and he said, I'm shot. And all I did, I mean, I grabbed him and I put him on my bed and I applied pressure. And I put a belt around him. I put two. Nobody was helping me. I was screaming for help. I called 911. No one helped. So I did everything that I thought was right. Just telling him he's gonna be okay. I've been trying to tell him stories to just calm him down. I've been trying to kiss him. And he wasn't talking. Arrived, my dad pushed me off of him and told me to go away. And I think that was his way of acting like he was helping the whole time. But he wasn't. And so, that night I was the only one put in cuffs. Because I was freaking out and screaming that he should be arrested. Because I was screaming that he murdered him. And I was kicked out. And I was thrown out on the streets.
Now, for me, that could have been prevented 100%. First of all, he sent her a text to say, hey, tell whoever you got in there they need to leave, okay? At that point, should have left. You don't say, oh, I'll just go sneak in my bedroom. And you heard her say, I left just to make him think he left out, but he went in there anyway. He went and just trying to hide underneath a bed to make him think that they left. Now, why are you even in anybody's house, especially a Mzungu house? Let me tell you something. When I grew up, one thing I was always told, you don't be in them folks' house. I don't care if you got a little friend, don't be in their house. Whatever you do, don't be in their house. If anything, if you let them come over here, but you know, that was just something just to be told. But in my neighborhood, I didn't have, you know, people, Mzungus around me like that. It was mostly a black community. Every blue moon, you may have a Mzungu move in, but they don't usually stay too long and they'll move right back out. But I was told that you do not go to their house because you don't know which one of them is a white supremacist. You don't know. So your best way is to stay from the house. Now, when I was growing up, definitely in the 90s, my grandmother, and definitely may she rest in power, she sat all of us down and said, look, I want to talk to y'all. It was like about 5-6 of us. And said, I need to talk to y'all because all you around the same age. And I need to talk to y'all about these little Mzungu girls. Now, she said, y'all growing up, He said, listen, I know some of them may like you. They may want to come at you and say they want you to date them and want to do all kind of little things with them. He said, but listen, you can't do that. He said, because let's say, my grandma said, let's say they may not even be a type of person that may be racist, but that father do not want his daughter with you for the most part. He said, he want his daughter with their own. And saying number two, those little women, it's too much trouble. He said, they accuse you of rape. They accuse you of stealing. They accuse you of beating her or something. And you could not have done it, and they still will lock you up because whatever she say goes. Not what you say, what she say. And one thing my grandmother said is this: you never want to be in a situation where her word can get you in just whatever kind of trouble. Then she went to it, talking about history, how, you know, those Mzungu females would lie and get, you know, black men strung up, people that she knew in Louisiana that got strung up, or certain race soldiers that killed a cousin of hers because he was dating a Mzungu female. That she said, listen, those are the women that you should just stay away from. Then she said, even if you was to get with one and have a child with one, that child gonna be so confused. That child gonna be dealing with too many problems because they not gonna like the Mzungu's not gonna like your kid, gonna say they black. Then some black folks, you know, may have an issue here and there if they try to identify too much with that other side. So it's gonna be too much confusion, too many problems. So she said, you got to, you know, listen, this is what she said. We got people in our community from ebony to ivory. But this is a but, she said. She said, only one outside our community I would not say much about at the time, she told us, like in the early 90s, you say would be, she said, Mexicans. She said, the only reason why is because we deal with some of the same issues that we have. Now, coming from Texas, I didn't have the issues that some of you brothers and sisters had with them in California. When I heard about what y'all deal with in California with them, I'm like, that was like foreign to me because I never had those issues and problems whatsoever, right? And it's ironic, that's really the only two groups of women I've ever dated in my life was black women and Hispanic women. That's just interesting that my grandma literally gave me my dating parameter. That's interesting. But what I'm saying is that was branded into my mind that you cannot date a Mzungu female, no matter how nice they are, because of their white supremacist male that's in their family or some cousin, right? Now, he should have not been in their house. Why are you, as a 21-year-old man, hiding underneath the bed like you're a child? You know, you're Washington State, so I know it's a lot of Mzungus over there, okay? If anything, if that's what he want to do, and you do what you want to do, that's your life. I can't tell you how to live it. Why didn't you say, go to your house? And then you heard the girl say it at the end, kill the brother and then put her out. She say she the one got put in handcuffs, not him. And he just killed the brother. You understand? Like, ain't no woman worth that to me. None. I don't care how they look. I don't care. Listen, as long as you live in this wicked system, that is a reality for you as a brother. You can say whatever you want to say and do what you want to do. That's your life. But don't be the brother that I have to make a report on. Because this system still operate that way. Any little thing they say, they can get a brother jammed up. Now you may say, well, black women can say, yeah, they can. They sure can. But they're not taking it serious. And we all know that as those Mzungu females. Why do you think you have sisters say, and I'm not talking about the ones with Zaddy, when Zaddy beat him up or Zaddy tried to do him something, talking about you not protecting me, not them. No, we don't even consider that. But we're talking about regular, ordinary sisters that say about, you know, they're not being protected because the society do not protect them. They protect the Mzungu female. That's a reality. This is why we have to have more and more brothers step up to protect the sisters in our community. We have to. Because you have some sicko dudes, like the one I just reported on, a few days ago, you know, preying on little girls in our community. We got to have brothers stepping up. You know, we got to. But this is just a cautionary tale, you know, really, in this story. Now, it took 2 years for him to be charged. And, you know, he was charged with second degree murder, but they didn't want to charge him. Not whatsoever. Remember, the girl says she got put in handcuffs and she didn't shoot nobody. She didn't kill nobody. But one thing that these Mzungu males do not like is to see a black man with one of their women. They just don't like that. Whatsoever. And a lot of brothers don't like it on the other way around either. Let's call that what it is. I mean, this country is screwed up. It is screwed up. That's why I'm saying I just really see that, you know, when it comes to that relationship between the Mzungus and black folks, the best relationship that we can have is just socially distancing. Because when we socially distance, we get along a little bit better, because it's too much hatred not coming from us. It's too much hatred coming from the other side. And like I said, I don't have time to deal with nobody's hatred. I don't want to deal with you. I'm socially distanced. I'm trying to protect myself from your corona, because, you know, you don't wear a mask anyway. So let me go ahead and stay away as much as possible. I tell black folks, you need to keep the socially distanced policy, you know, within our whole community, like, just forever. Like I said, as long as you're living in Babylon, that's for sure. But I hate this happened. I hate the mom, you know, lost her son. But you got to teach your sons, dads, moms, that it's not a game out here. All that love is love, and we all the same. Not in America. We're not. We live in a racial hierarchy, a white supremacist system. And these people, when they don't get their way, they kill, steal, and destroy. So talk to your sons. Talk to them. I see these little young black boys, that's all they want to walk around here with is them little Mzungu females. I'm not even saying women, young girls or whatever, like, that's outside of the community, but they know Mzungu, I'm going to say. They're not even a lot of times fooling with them. They're fooling, you know what I'm saying? And then I've done stories where the Mzungu female sends a young brother some pictures of herself, then he get charged with child porn. Understand? Right in Louisiana, of course. That type of thing is be happening. She not gonna get in trouble. You. So please talk to your sons. Talk to them. Because when you jammed up, or when you lose your life like this, this is sad, but this could have been prevented. This could have been prevented. He should have been talked to a long time ago. Talk to your kids, because living in this country, if you don't talk to your kids, you know, I'm going to just put it out there. It's your fault if something happened to them, because you didn't want them. Now, if you warned them, you laced them up with the game in this country, if something happened anyway, well, you know, you did your part. But leave me a comment. Let me know what you think about this particular story. Sad, but it could have been prevented. I'm just really shaking my head. Yes, the young woman will be traumatized about it, to watch that man die like that. But like I said, this country's wicked. Please talk to your sons and your daughters too, obviously.